Today, we're going to do more than just talk about economics. We're actually going to solve a puzzle, and we're going to use real numbers from Israel's economy in 2022 to do it.
Okay, let's dive right in. What you see here are seven major financial events that happened in a single year. You can think of them as puzzle pieces. Our job is to figure out how to arrange these pieces to tell the story of a nation's economy.
So you're looking at all this, right? Exports, loans, real estate. Where do you even begin to make sense of it all? Well, to solve any puzzle, you need the right tool.
And that tool is called the balance of payments. It's basically a country's official scorecard for every single financial transaction it has with the rest of the world.
The simplest way to think about it is like a country's bank statement with the whole world. Seriously, money coming in is a credit, like a deposit, and money going out is a debit, like a withdrawal. That's it.
Now, what's really interesting is how we organize all these flows of money. We split them into two main buckets: the current account, which is for day-to-day stuff like trade, and the financial account, which is for bigger investments. So let's build this thing out transaction by transaction and put each piece where it belongs.
All right, let's start slotting these in. The government grant and the exports, that's money coming into the country, so that's a credit in the current account. Imports are also in the current account, but that's money flowing out, so it's a debit. Now, things like repaying a loan or buying stocks and real estate in another country, those are long-term investments. So they go into the financial account, and since the money is leaving Israel, they're all debits.
But hold on a second. What about that last item? An Israeli bank paying interest to Israeli investors. This is a classic misdirection you see in problems like this. It's a huge amount of money, but where does it fit in our puzzle?
And here is the absolute number one rule you have to remember. Because this transaction happened completely inside Israel, between two Israeli parties, it doesn't belong on the balance of payments at all. It's not money flowing in or out of the country. It's a distractor, a red herring, just to make sure we're paying attention.
Okay, now that we've tossed out that trick piece, we can finally get to the answer. With all the real international transactions in place, it's time to do the math.
So first we add up all the credits, all the money that came into Israel. That comes out to $1.4 billion. Then we add up all the debits, all the money that left Israel, and that total is $1.86 billion.
So, what's the bottom line? Well, you take the money in, and you subtract the money out, and you get this number, negative $460 million. And that is the solution to our puzzle.
So what does a negative number here actually mean? It means the country spent more foreign money than it brought in. That's what we call a balance of payments deficit. And just like if you spend more than you make in a month, you have to dip into your savings, right? A country does the same thing. To cover that shortfall, Israel had to dip into its savings of foreign currency, which means its reserves went down by $460 million that year.
Okay, great. We solved the puzzle, we got the number, but why should anyone care? Why does this actually matter to a normal person? Well, it all connects to one of the most powerful forces in the entire economy. The exchange rate.
And this right here, this shows a fundamental economic tug of war. Think about it. When the dollar is strong, meaning it's worth more shekels, Israeli exporters are thrilled. $1 million sale overseas suddenly brings in way more shekels back home. But for importers and regular consumers, it's bad news. All that stuff we buy from other countries, cars, phones, clothes, it all just got more expensive. It's this constant balancing act.
And this doesn't just happen in a vacuum. It kicks off this powerful chain reaction, like a set of dominoes falling through the whole economy. A higher dollar exchange rate makes exporting more profitable. So what do those profitable companies do? They expand. They grow. And to grow, they have to hire more people. And more people getting hired means, eventually, the entire country's unemployment rate can go down.
Now, because this connection is so incredibly important, you can bet that most countries don't just sit back and hope for the best. Oh no. They have a strategy.
Israel's strategy is something called a managed float. The idea is to kickstart that exact chain reaction we just saw. So, the Bank of Israel doesn't just watch from the sidelines, it actively jumps into the market and buys up billions of US dollars. All this buying creates artificial demand, which pushes the dollar's value higher and gives that all-important boost to the nation's exporters.
So, what's the long-term result of this managed float policy? Well, look at this number. Over the decades, Israel has built up a massive war chest of foreign currency reserves. We're talking about $220 billion. This isn't an accident. It's the financial firepower they've built up from years of strategically managing their currency.
And that brings us right back to where we started, with a puzzle. That $460 million deficit we calculated seems pretty small now, but we can see it's part of a much bigger, much more delicate picture. A country can manage its currency to boost jobs, which is great, but the trade-off is that it often makes things more expensive for its own citizens. So that leaves us with a final, pretty provocative question for you to think about. How much control is too much, and who gets to decide on the right balance?